Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. Today in this module, we will be discussing about e-waste or electronic waste. In this module, we will discuss about its definition, sources, classification, management aspects, treatment and disposal options. Now, what is e-waste? E-waste or electronic waste are items that are generated from electrical or electronic usage. Examples can be large appliances like refrigerators, ovens, televisions, mobile phones, personal computers, laptops, pen drives, floppies, iPads, etc. Now, what is a problem? As you all know, e-waste problem is being increasing and it's gaining an alarming attention because of its environmental effects associated with it. According to World Bank report of 2012, it says the waste or e-waste generation is around 1.3 billion and it is expected to increase to up to 2.2 billion by 2025. Now, there are both developing and developed countries are facing problem of e-waste management. As I told you earlier, e-waste is gaining importance because there is lack of awareness among the public about its health and the environmental effects. Now, though it has valuable materials in it, it also is associated with lot of environmental effects. Normally, these low income group people, the rag pickers, they use these electronic waste, they dismantle it with thinking using it as a source of income because of the available of these valuable materials. The way of dismantling these electronic waste is not proper. This results in a lot of toxic effects on the workers associated with dismantling these electronic waste. Hence, it is essential for us to have a proper management practice. With this introduction, now let's look into the learning objectives of this module. The learning objectives of this module include, first, we will define what is e-waste, we will understand what are the sources of generation, what are the challenges actually involved in during e-waste generation, we will also study about or understand about the classification of e-waste and we will know about e-waste management with a special emphasis on the e-waste management in India. Finally, we will also explain the various steps involved in e-waste management or treatment. E-waste management, that is treatment. Now, what is e-waste? E-waste is otherwise or also known as electronic waste or waste electrical and electronic equipment, which is abbreviated as WEEE, or it is also called as end of life electronics, abbreviated as EOL. E-waste are electronic devices which has no longer value to its owner. As I told you, examples can be refrigerators, air conditioners, cell phones, personal computers, stereos, consumer electronic items, laptops, pen drives, hard disks, floppy disks, etc., which are being discarded by their users. In India, e-waste is broadly categorized into two groups based on their usage. One is the information technology and telecommunication equipment, and the other one is consumer electrical and electronic items. In general, e-waste is divided into five groups based on the materials which are present in them. 1. Ferrous metals, 2. Non-ferrous metals, 3. Glass, 4. Plastics and other materials are also there. If you see, iron and steel nearly contributes around 48% of the e-waste. That is almost equal to half the total weight of the waste electrical and electronic equipments. Plastic contributes to 21% of e-waste and other non-ferrous metals contributes to around 13% of its weight. And among that, among the non-ferrous metals, copper alone contributes to 7%. Now, this figure shows you the typical material fraction in waste electrical and electronic equipments. The composition is given based on its weight percentage. The maximum contributor, as I told you earlier, it is iron and steel, followed by the non-flame retarded plastic, then comes your copper, and the least one is rubber, contributing to 0.9%. Now, what are the challenges associated with e-waste management? Some of the challenges include, they are globally traded due to the presence of recyclable material in that. Almost 60% of the material are recyclable, and hence they are globally traded from developed to developing countries. Second challenge is, a lot of toxic and valuable metals are present in this e-waste. Also, the cost of repair for the electronic items are very high when compared to low cost of electronic items, which means that the purchase of an electronic item is much lower when compared to repairing the same electronic item. Next challenge is, recycling is very expensive and the space availability in landfill is less. Also, improper methods of dismantling these electronic items by unskilled workers create a lot of health and environmental effects. Lastly, the lack of proper regulation is also a biggest challenge in e-waste management. Now, we look into the challenges of e-waste management in detail. As I told you earlier, nearly 60% of recyclable material in e-waste has made the global trade in e-waste from developed to developing countries, because they get a profitable business. Secondly, the global trade in e-waste management from developed to developing countries has been increasing annually. E-waste contains both toxic and valuable materials. The presence of these valuable materials encourages the international trade. The presence of toxic pollutants in e-waste makes its effective management a challenging task for the developing countries. Also, the method used for separating or dismantling this e-waste is archaic, that is, it's an ancient method where there is no proper understanding how the e-waste has to be dismantled. This results in causing a lot of damage to the workers as well as to the environment. The increasing quantity of e-waste is attributed to higher cost of repair of electronic equipment together with decreasing cost of equipment. As I told you, it's cheaper to buy a new electronic item rather than going for repairing the old electronic item. So, it is better to discard the older one and buy a new one. Most often, instead of repair, the quantity of e-waste generated ends up in landfills, or they are mostly incinerated along with municipal solid waste, leading to a lot of damage to the environment. The regulations framed by the local government bodies to manage e-waste are still not in use due to decreased availability of landfill space and increased recognition of toxic nature of e-waste. The regulations by the local government has been framed in order to manage the e-waste because of decreased availability of landfill space and increased recognition of toxic nature of e-waste. The regulation has made the recycling of e-waste more expensive. Hence, it is essential to choose an alternate, cheaper route for managing this waste by exporting it to developing countries of the south. Almost 80% of the e-waste, which is generated globally, is being exported into Asia. The increasing quantity of e-waste is not only due to economic growth or the consumer behavior. Also, e-waste is seen as a resource for income generation for people below poverty line. This involves a lot of unskilled labor into this sector. The informal sector that is involved in dismantling and recovery process of valuable materials are more. They also engage in resource recovery from e-waste because there are a lot of valuable metals embedded in this e-waste. So, they adopt a lot of environmentally unsound practices. Also, the lack of proper regulation to handle it makes e-waste management a challenging issue. Now, let's look into the various sources of e-waste. The sources of e-waste include small household equipment, maybe some electronic toys or something like that. Second, large household equipments, refrigerators, PCs, washing machine, mobiles, etc. IT sector, which includes the office equipment. The fourth category is hospital sector, which uses a lot of medical equipments. And finally, the institutional sector, where laptop, computer, floppies, pen drives, hard disks are thrown off. The sources of e-waste generation are also very large, ranging from individual users to household to organization. It covers various sectors. Now, let's look into the classification of e-waste. The classification of e-waste varies from country to country. So, there is no generic system. According to the United Nations University classification, also known as UNUKEYS, e-waste is classified into the following categories. They are classified based on products of similar function, based on comparable material composition, in terms of material used for making the e-waste. Next, in terms of average weight, end of life characteristics, and life span distribution. Total around 54 categories of e-waste are grouped under 10 primary categories. In India, e-waste is categorized into two groups, which is listed below in the following table. This categorization is done according to MOEFCC, Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change, report 2016. First category is information technology and telecommunication equipment. Examples, it can be personal computer, laptops, notebook, notepads, iPads, iPods, mobiles, cordless phones, typewriters, telefax machines, telephones, etc. And second category is consumer electrical and electronic items, which includes television sets, which can be an LED or LCD screens, refrigerator, washing machines, air conditioners, and centralized air conditioning plants. Now, how can this e-waste be managed, which is very, very important in current scenario? E-waste management is based on the principle of extended producer responsibility, which is abbreviated as EPR. Now, EPR is defined as an environmental protection strategy that makes the manufacturer of the product responsible for the entire life cycle of the product, and especially for the take back, recycling, and final disposal of the product. Which means, for example, if a television or any item, let us say it is produced or manufactured by the Samsung company. Now, they will be responsible, or they should take care of the entire life cycle of the product, including they should also take back once the material is worn out, they should take back, they should recycle, and they will be responsible for the final disposal. That is called as extended producer responsibility. There are five parameters which has to be considered when you design an EPR for an e-waste management system. They are legal regulation, system coverage, system financing, producer responsibility, and compliances. The parameters, all these parameters which are listed above, that is, these five parameters are closely interlinked and they play an important role in the effective management of waste electrical and electronic equipments. This linking of the manufacturing phase of the product with its disposal by EPR will encourage the manufacturer to go for better product design to enable easy upgrading and recycling. According to the Swiss RD, that is the Return, Taking Back and Disposal of Electrical and Electronic Equipment Act 1998, it promotes collection and recycling of e-waste, and it also restricts the use of certain hazardous substances when you manufacture any electrical or electronic item. And this is being followed by many of the European Union countries. Many countries in Asia like Japan, South Korea, Taiwan also have their own regulation for tackling or managing this e-waste. In developing countries, due to lack of these regulation, it has created a serious challenge in e-waste management. Developing countries like India and China have now implemented legislation in line with European Union. That is, they have followed the legislation of European Union Waste Electrical and Electronic Equipment Directives and formulated their own legislation. In developing countries, there is a large group of participants, as mentioned, in the informal sector, who use the e-waste as a source of income for their everyday living. That is why a major problem in e-waste management is still existing. The informal sector make a source of living by the resource extraction from this waste through primitive backyard recycling, who cannot be ignored in e-waste management system. So, the informal sector or unskilled labor, they have to be integrated with the formal e-waste recycler, and a proper management practice should be formulated, especially in the collection of e-waste and their recycling. Now, the next important step in e-waste management is its treatment. As mentioned earlier, e-waste contains a lot of valuable materials. It contains ferrous, plastic, it also contains other non-ferrous metals, etc. Now, it's a mixture of valuable material that is recoverable and recyclable with toxic substance that needs to be safely disposed, as its treatment is also complex. E-waste requires both labor-intensive manual segregation with capital-intensive technical process for separation of toxic waste. They are labor-intensive. That means it involves a lot of labor to dismantle this waste and segregate the valuable materials present in the e-waste. Now, handling of e-waste by beginning with manual dismantling has been recommended, as they are the best practices for waste treatment. The dismantled waste will then be segregated or separated into glass, copper, steel, aluminium, plastic, and other printed circuit boards. The total content, if you see, the printed circuit board in e-waste is around 3 to 5% by weight, while the other metal, glass, plastic, etc., they constitute about 95 to 97%. Now, the hazardous components like the capacitors, CRT screens, CFC gases, light bulbs and batteries are also separated and removed at this stage. Now, after this, the mechanical processing starts. Mechanical processing is normally a large scale operation which enables the increase of recyclable materials in a dedicated fashion, and it also helps in further separation of hazardous waste. The mechanical processing involves a crushing unit, a shredding unit, a magnetic and eddy current separator, and an air separator. Crushing means all these e-waste will be put into a unit and it is crushed into small pieces. Crushing will not result in uniform particle size, it will not be homogeneous. When you talk about shredders, you can achieve uniform size. Again, shredding means it is cutting off the bigger particles into smaller size. Here, there is some sort of homogeneity can be seen. The next step in the mechanical processing is the magnetic and eddy current separator. You use either magnetic field or an eddy current for separating the ferrous and non-ferrous metals, and this is a means of segregation or separation of waste materials. Next one is the air separator. In air separator, the small, it is called as air separator or air classifier, where the air is blown. When the air is blown on the opposite direction of where you feed the items or the shredded materials, the smaller items will be blown off and the larger particles will settle down. This is also a way by which the component separation occurs. Finally, the gas emissions which are released are filtered and the effluents will be treated to minimize the environmental effect. Final step in e-waste recycling is refining. So, now these photographs will show you the crushers and shredders. The first one, the first image is a crusher, where you can find a big wheels in a sort of pulley arrangement. When the waste, the electronic waste is fed, it will crush into smaller particles. On the other image is a shredder, where you get uniform size particles. This is a magnetic or an eddy separator. You can see it works in a pulley. There's a conveyor belt sort of arrangement connected to a pulley, and in the conveyor belt you will have the electric current or the magnetic field applied. So in that case, what will happen, all the metals or the ferrous metals will get attracted or attached to this conveyor belt. The moment it crosses the pulley, there will not be any magnetic field or current, so all the materials will be falling down, and based on that you can segregate the ferrous and non-ferrous metals. As I told you, as mentioned earlier, the final step in e-waste management is refining. Now, most of the fractions obtained here are refined because they can be sold as a secondary raw material or other byproducts. During the refining process, you have to give a lot of attention to metals, glass and plastics. At the end of refining and after extraction of valuable fraction, the residue which is left out, it's of no use and it is toxic. So its disposal has to be done in a proper way. Normally the disposal is done along with the hazardous waste. The disposal option, the landfill for hazardous waste, is different, unlike the municipal solid waste, and hence the e-waste which is, or the residue which is left out after these process, they should be disposed of safely in a landfill along with the hazardous waste. Now this is a simple flow diagram. For example, if you have a scrap IC board, what are the process which occurs, the steps in the scrap IC board treatment is depicted in this flow chart. If you can see the scrap IC board, it undergoes primary crushing in a primary crusher, and then it is passed on through a magnetic supporter where the iron materials or the ferrous metals can be separated out, and then it is taken to a hammer mill. Now, hammer mill is nothing but you have a rotating drum inside which you have two or three hammers attached to it. When the items, the drum will be rotating, when the electronic waste comes in contact with the hammer, it will be crushed, it will be beaten, and it will break off into smaller particles. Now, once it is done, the dust which is released off is collected through a cyclonic separator, and once again it is passed on to a magnetic separator to remove the iron or ferrous metals which are still left over in the waste, and after that once again it is sent to an air classifier. Now, in air classifier, you separate the plastic materials and then you take it to an eddy current separator where your aluminium waste, aluminium metals are separated, and finally it is taken to an electrostatic separator where copper wires and copper metal is been removed. The rest which is left out is the fiberglass and other resin material. How this e-waste is managed in India? According to the United Nations report 2015, India is the fifth largest producer of e-waste in the world, and they discard around 1.7 million tons of electronic and electrical equipments. If you remember in the introduction, I told you it is the e-waste generation is 1.3 billion according to the World Bank report 2012. And they have projected it that it will extend up to 2.2 billion by 2025. So India will also be a major contributor within this value. So the e-waste stream in the country, it is rising 3 times much faster than the municipal waste. The government institutions and the public and private sector alone are almost contributing to 70% of the e-waste that is generated in India. The e-waste management in India, they follow 3 steps, and mostly the highly organized informal sector is being involved in the management step. The three steps which are followed include the collection, their segregation and dismantling. After dismantling, they are either recycled or the residue is taken to the landfill. Again, the informal sector engaged in the dismantling of these electronic waste, they are obviously from the poor and rural sector. And the informal sector, they handle almost 95% of the total e-waste, that is recycled. The recycling by this informal sector is done in a primitive way, and hence it causes a lot of damage to the workers along with the environment. And they also result in a loss of valuable material due to the insufficient methods. That means, since they are not skilled and they are not aware of, they are not aware of proper means by which dismantling is done, a lot of valuable metals or materials which are present in the e-waste are also lost. Studies on environmental and toxicological impact of improper treatment of e-waste is recognized, and you can see a lot of data which is available in recent times, which is having a great impact on the recycling workers in India. The informal way of recycling this e-waste is mostly done in the urban slums or in the outskirts of the city, and mostly you can see children involved in this separation, and they are affected with respiratory problems. And Delhi, the capital of India, has been recognized as a major hub for this informal recycling for the entire country. Almost 25,000 people are employed in this informal recycling of e-waste. Now, if you look into the e-waste regulation in India, e-waste is regarded as hazardous waste mostly because of the presence of hazardous substances in it, and also they cause serious environmental damage and hence not managed properly. Though they have a separate rule for hazardous waste, which is the Hazardous Waste Management and Handling Transboundary Movement Rule 2008, still they have framed a separate rules for e-waste because of its unique nature. The rule was enacted in 2012 and it was called as E-Waste Management and Handling Rule 2012. This rule is further being amended by taking into consideration the existing e-waste management operation, and now it is recognized as E-Waste Management Rule 2016, and it came into force recently, last year in October 2016. Now, some of the salient features of this revised e-waste rule or regulation is, one, it is based on the principle of EPR, where the producer of the equipment has been mandated or advised to channelize the e-waste that is generated after the use of the equipment and manage it in an environmentally sound manner. I gave you an example. For example, if Samsung is a producer, now he should be responsible, or he is in charge for collecting the material at the end of use, and he is in charge for the complete life cycle of the material. He should take care of its recycling, he should take care of its safe disposal, etc. The producer can do this by implementing a take back system or setting up a collection center, or both by having agreed arrangements with authorized dismantler or recycler. Now, how can he do this? Like, how can he collect from many places? So, a collection centers can be established where, if your Samsung material or Samsung product is not working, you can go to the collection center, you can give it to them, so that based on an agreed arrangement, they will take it back and then they can do further processing. Also, if not, they can also have an agreement with these dismantler, authorized dismantler or recycler. They can have an agreement between them, and the recycler or the dismantler, they can give the items to the respective collection center. They could do this either individually, or it can be a collective effort through a producer responsibility organization. It organizes and defines each of the stakeholders who are involved with the production of the electronic equipment and management of waste generated at the end of its useful life. Namely, the stakeholders can be a producer, manufacturer, consumer, bulk consumer, collection center, dealer, e-retailer, refurbisher, or they can also be a dismantler or recycler. Now, the responsibility of each stakeholder is been clearly written in the rules. They have to follow these regulations. The specific targets have also been set for the producers with the expectation of managing almost 30% of the waste generated during the first 2 years of the implementation of the rule, and they also say that this target of 30% should increase to 70% within the seventh year of implementation of the rule. This will help in proper management of e-waste. Also, the penalty of non-compliance. If you are not complying with the regulation of e-waste, which is proposed, which has come into force in 2016, then you will have to face the consequences. That is, the penalty of non-compliance of meeting the target includes cancellation of EPR authorization, which would result in the producer not being able to put products in the market until EPR authorization is re-granted. See, if the company is not agreeing or if they are not doing their work properly, then their EPR will be cancelled. EPR authorization. If EPR is not there, then they cannot sell the items or goods in the market. If they are not able to sell, then there will be a loss. So, obviously, it is abiding for them to have the EPR. So, they will obviously do their work and they will comply with the rules. Apart from having a planned system for managing e-waste, the producers are also required to reduce the amount of hazardous substances in their equipment. If you remember, according to Swiss rule, I told you they restrict the use of hazardous materials in the manufacturing of e-waste. Likewise, the Indian government, they have said the amount of hazardous waste should be minimized during the manufacturing of electronic items. The equipment should not contain any lead, mercury or hexavalent chromium, that is chromium 6+, polybrominated biphenyls or polybrominated diphenyl ethers beyond a maximum concentration, that is 0.1% by weight, and for cadmium it is 0.01% by weight in homogeneous materials. To summarize, in this module we started defining what is electronic waste, how electronic waste are being called by other names like waste, electrical and electronic equipments. Also, they are called as electrical and electronic equipments by Indian government. We have defined what is electronic waste. Then we started looking about the various sources from where electronic waste are generated, which includes large appliances like the refrigerator, air conditioners, washing machines, laptops, pen drives, other electronic items like floppy disks, DVD writers, video recorders, stereos, etc., etc. And we have also seen what are the main sources of from where these e-waste is being generated. And almost 70% of the e-waste is generated from these institutions, especially the public institutions and the private sector like universities, schools, colleges and other private departments and IT sectors. Then we looked into the classification of e-waste. According to the Indian government, they are classified into two sectors. Then we looked into the various challenges which are disturbing or affecting the e-waste generation. Then we started looking into the various management aspects of e-waste, both globally as well as in Indian context, and special emphasis was given regarding the e-waste management rules and regulations framed by the Indian government, that is Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change 2016. We also discussed about the various treatment options which are available for e-waste management. Thank you.